Welcome to Dr. Katie Woodley, the natural pet doctor, your host for the summit for the next few days. I'm excited to this special kickoff event with three of our speakers for the summit. I'm joined by Dr. Nick Thompson, a veterinarian who's been fighting for responsible, species-appropriate raw food feeding for pets for over 25 years. Dr. Nick is the founding president of the International Raw Feeding Veterinary Society and established his specialist practice, Holistic Vet, in 1999. When not trying to convert the world to a species-appropriate diet, Nick has been known to run barefoot, swim, and strive to eat real, sometimes foraged food, not all at the same time. Also joining us is Dr. Katie Congas, a veterinarian who owns Integrative Veterinary Care in San Diego, California. Dr. Katie's areas of special interest include nutrition, functional medicine, dental health, and pain management. And last but not least, I'd like to welcome Dr. Susan Bohr. Dr. Susan has been a small animal veterinarian for the past 16 years with a focus on traditional Chinese medicine and food therapy for the last 10 years. She believes food is the first medicine and launched Qi Dog, which delivers food therapy meals to your door. Welcome, everyone. I am so excited to have you all here and to dive a little bit deeper into gut health and how food is the foundation for health. So to kind of start with and set the scene for this panel, as we all understand as veterinarians, dogs' gut health is so important to their overall health. 70 to 80% of their immune system's present in the gut. And if we're not feeding them the right foods to optimize gut health and the microbiome, then our dogs are at a higher risk of developing disease later on. These types of diseases can vary from allergies to diarrhea to autoimmune disease to anxiety to even cancer. This is why this topic is so important to every pet parent listening. But before we dive in, I'd like each speaker to take a few minutes to talk about your topic for the Pet Summit and what you're hoping pet parents learn from the presentation or interview that you did with us over the next couple of days. All right, Nick, I'm going to start with you.
Okay, great. Katie, it's great to be here. Thank you very much for the invitation. And it was fun doing my presentation, which was basically looking at top tips for those just starting and for those who, because everybody who starts with raw food is terrified. Always. I've never met anybody who has boldly struck into raw food and didn't have some reservation in their heart in some way. So really, I've just gone through my top tips to help you get over the anxiety, to be able to look at raw feeding with with eyes open. And I've given you some top tips to get you started. I hope you really enjoy it. And if you've been feeding for a while, do check out the talk, because you might pick up a few little tips in there that might be very, very useful. I hope you enjoy it.
Thanks, Nick. All right, Katie, you're next.
All right, thank you. My topic is essentially, the broad topic is toxins in food, because that is such a huge issue for all of us in the modern day world. But certainly pets are faced with a very heavy toxic burden, even compared to their human counterparts. And I'm all about feeding a species appropriate diet as well. But many of the pet foods on the market have a high ratio of carbohydrates in the food, which is not, you know, appropriate and natural in a species aligned diet. And many people don't realize, we know, many of us are very familiar with the issues with processed food, but a lot of people aren't as familiar with the fact that a lot of the plant-based carbohydrates that are showing up in pet foods like oats and lentils and peas and, you know, chickpeas and all this kind of stuff, potatoes, these plants are grown with very heavy levels of toxins these days. Namely, glyphosates is what I really dive deep into in this presentation. And glyphosates, just so everybody knows, that is the original herbicide that was included in the patented Monsanto's Roundup product, which now the patent's lifted. There's, you know, more than 70 products with glyphosate in them. And it has become so ubiquitously used in agriculture and even beyond. People are spraying lawns and their homes. And so we're going to go into also contact exposure for dogs because they do get so much from the environment, but focus a great deal on food and a lot of the toxins coming from foods. Now, how this ties into our wonderful broad topic of gut health and how important that is that glyphosate, many people realize that Roundup is carcinogenic, it can cause cancer, many problems with it, but it also destroys the gut lining. It is one of the biggest offenders of leaky gut syndrome. And that is where all, you know, all health problems generally, and back to Hippocrates' wisdom, all disease starts in the gut. And now, of course, modern medicine, we do realize that, that is essentially true. And so toxins is a big sort of hidden factor where a lot of this is coming from, especially for our pets. So we dive deep into that and explain what are better choices to feed your pet, how a species appropriate diet is going to, by default, be a whole lot better, and explaining why. And then how just guiding parents to make sensible choices on pet food, and finish it up with things that we can do to support and promote gut health for our pets.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Katie. Mm-hmm. It's a great topic. And last but not least, Dr. Susan.
Hi. Katie, you and I had a really good talk about a lot of the things that we both know from Chinese medicine. So my background is Western medicine, and then also traditional Chinese medicine, which is herbs, acupuncture, Tuina, which is like a massage technique, and food therapy. In Chinese medicine, food is very much part of how we treat dogs, how we help with imbalances, how we prevent imbalances. And in Western medicine, we just kind of totally lost that, especially for a dog, for, you know, actually everyone but humans. Humans were finally starting to realize clean food matters. Real foods, we're finally realizing the damage that comes from processed foods. Veterinary medicine just has not made that connection in our dogs. So we just kind of think the dogs eat kibble and we eat, you know, kale and asparagus, and we really try to get a nice, clean, varied diet. So traditional Chinese medicine says dogs, cats, just like us, should eat clean food, real food. So all our basis of all our recipes and all our thoughts on food therapy in traditional Chinese medicine is start with real food, start with quality ingredients. And if you're maybe you have an athlete, maybe that's a great dog that you would feed raw food to. You know, if you have a senior dog who's getting very deficient, very weak, that one you might really cook it and you might make it like a nice stew. So you're really thinking about the way in which you eat food. It has to, one, be quality ingredients, two, how you eat that food. So if I had a dog who's tending to have a lot of inflammation or a lot of like what we call like heat in the body, we would try to pick some cooling foods in Chinese medicine. So we would use that as a way of using food as medicine when we're trying to bring in some way to sort of mitigate an imbalance in the dog. So that's kind of how we started all our consults with our clients, is how can we get a cooked diet that's going to be healthier for you. As a client, we balance it. That's why we made Chi Dog diets, so that we can actually send them to clients, have balanced real food diets, because we really do think that food is the first medicine. So that little puppy, when they're beautiful, perfect baby, we want to keep that strength and keep that livelihood. So when they get to be senior, they still have a lot of that. So now that I have fed so many dogs, taken them off processed kibble and put them on real food diets, we've really seen transformations that you can see, you know what I mean, in the skin, in the coat. So those are results and sort of the consequences of how you feed. In Chinese medicine, we have a saying, if you want a healthy coat, healthy skin, you need healthy blood. So you need like good quality, you know, food in you to be able to see that in your health. So that's kind of how we bring food therapy into the idea of healing our gut.
I love it. And I love that there's so many broad topics. Those are just a few of the amazing speakers and presentations that are a part of this Gut Health Summit. And yes, a lot of us, have you noticed, we talk about fresh food diets, but we know there's a lot of pet parents out there that are still looking at labels. And so many pet parents are super confused about how to pick that best pet food. And they're not really sure where to start when looking at those pet food labels. So I'd love to have each and every one of you discuss briefly, maybe just a few top things that pet parents should be aware of when they're looking at a pet food label, and also why. So Dr. Katie, do you want to go first?
Sure. So the top three things that I would recommend for people and really encourage people is to try and choose something fresh over processed. So the first thing I would look at is, you know, maybe even beyond the label, is just what format of food, you know, are we feeding? And the least process that we can do, you know, whether that's fresh, whether it's, you know, cooked or raw, or a low process like an air dried or something like that, but definitely trying to stay on the fresher end of things rather than a processed. The second thing I would recommend for people to look at is the level of carbohydrates. I mean, I really try to stay, you know, species aligned, and I'm sure Dr. Thompson has a lot to say about this, but species aligned diet, species appropriate diet is going to have much less carbohydrates than the standard pet foods on the market. And when looking at pets with either gut disease or chronic disease of any kind, high carbohydrates, and which, you know, break down ultimately to sugars, are driving so much disease and inflammation and gut problems and pancreatitis and, you know, so many things because pets aren't designed to eat that much carbs. The thing that I think is also notable in looking at carbohydrates on the label is that they are now doing label splitting. And so if you are seeing like pea starch, pea protein, pea, you know, powder, all these things that are broken down into smaller categories. So the meat could be at the top part of the label or the beginning of the label, and all these other things are, you know, if there's three categories of pea breakdown, then usually peas outweighs the actual protein of the meat. I mean, there's some plant-based protein in there, but we really want that animal-based protein. So be on the lookout for label splitting as well. And then the final thing I would say, if possible, there's not that many brands of food that are doing it, but if possible, choose organic, choose clean food, the best that you can. And you will see that in my presentation, because I talk all about how there have been lots of studies to show that food that is labeled organic, the vast majority of the time, there are no measurable traces of glyphosate in it. So a lot of people dispute whether organic really means organic. And, you know, maybe that has, you know, some geographical distribution on, but at least foods that were studied here in our area in the United States, if they were labeled organic, they were clean from glyphosates the vast majority of the time. So checking for organic would also be something I would highly recommend.
That's great. Thank you so much, Katie. Susan, you want to go next?
Yeah, absolutely. I would say, as my biggest sort of recommendation is as little kibble to no kibble as possible. And that's just because it's so, there's it's just processed. Like, you couldn't get, it's, you know, it's like us eating Doritos and Hot Pockets all day. Okay, you could have a little Dorito, but if you had something else, you know, that would be, and usually we recommend to add in cooked foods, real foods, just to try to get some actual nutrition. So, and the other thing that I would add is, and I agree with Dr. Katie that more fresh you can go, the better. So if it's between like a dehydrated and a kibble, go dehydrated and cook a little extra. You know, and we have a lot of people who do like cooked foods, and if they want to make it a little less expensive, they'll cook some of their own. We have a lot of people who do kind of a half and half, you know, do a half cheat dog, half home cook, which is great. The other thing I would say is if you have to do a kibble, I would suggest no venison, no lamb. And they're super hot meats in general. So that's why we'll find recommendations for like fish and turkey, which are more cooling. In Chinese medicine, we see venison and lamb as meats that warm you. Kibble or all processed food warms you. Warming is akin to pro-inflammatory. So we would say if you have to do a, you know, kind of processed-ish food, don't pick a lamb or a venison. Pick something cooler. That's why the ducks and the rabbits. We do pork, although it's a neutral meat overall. We like to do some of the porks, which can be very hydrating, but we really try to almost, I never recommend venison or lamb, like ever.
Great. Those are great tips. And so Nick, you're up last.
Okay. In the UK, we do use venison and lamb because it's cooler here. Yeah. And so that's geographical. And I think the Chinese would agree, you know, if you talk to the doctors in the north and the doctors in the south, they would approach things slightly differently because the Chinese in their wisdom would look at the environment as well as the temperament and the constitution of the person. And that's, they were the first really to look at holistic medicine. So totally agree with everything that Susan is saying there. So thank you. Thank you, Susan. What would I say for some top tips on labels? Number one is if you don't recognize something on a label, if you can't read it, yeah, if it's so chemical that you can't read it, you'd be really careful about that. And the more of those chemical sounding names that you see on the label, the more you need to walk away from that product, I would suggest. Because you've got to ask yourself, what have they done to this product such that they need to put the chemicals back in? We and our dogs have evolved over millions of years to eat real food, not chemicals. We haven't even evolved to eat calcium carbonate, which is chalk. Yeah. Plants eat rocks. Herbivores eat plants. Carnivores eat herbivores. That's the way it's been since the planet started, and that's the way it should be. So to feed these chemicals and unadulterated kind of rocky minerals, I don't think it's a great idea. The best way to get nutrients is through food, either raw or lightly cooked. That is the way to do it, because that's the way it's always been done. We can make raw and fresh food diets even better than they were previously by just combining foods and being very careful about how we present them and how we chop and what have you. But the foundational, let's eat food to get healthy. That's the bottom line. So if you don't recognize it, walk away. The other thing I would suggest, so that was kind of two. If you don't recognize it, and the more there are, the more you want to walk away. So that's two. Is that cheating to do that?
No.
And then, okay, so my third one. I can tell you about this stuff all day. So I promise not to go on too much. And so another one is the salt divide. Salt goes into dog food at about 0.5% to 1%. So it means, and it's usually on a kibble, it's usually about 1/7 on the list. And what you can tell is that anything that's at the on the other side, yeah, because the most common ingredient is the biggest ingredient goes at the front, and then the less and less and less and less. So anything on south beyond the where salt is going to be lower than about 0.5%. Okay, and therefore it's probably not going to be having much nutritional value. So just be careful of anything below there. Those would be my three: chemicals, the number of chemicals, and anything below the salt divide looks great on the label, you know, green tea or turmeric. But if there's so little in there that they just put it in to get it on the label, you're probably putting your money in the wrong direction.
I think those are all great. And also to go along with a few little tips to add into everyone's, goes with treats. So if you're seeing those on treat, like a treat label, walk away, put it back, leave it. The other big thing too, going along with the organic that Katie was talking about, are looking for human grade. So a lot of people don't realize that most meats, most proteins used in processed food diets are feed grade. And it's not what we get at the grocery store. So looking for human grade, and with organic, there's less brands that have that, but it's something to keep an eye out for. Other big red warning flags would be artificial flavors, your preservatives. Those aren't as common, like your colorings. But honestly, I had a brand that I was looking at for a client the other day and I was shocked. I was like, what is happening? I haven't seen that in a long time. So being able to identify that, put the bag back, walk away. And then for a lot of people who are feeding like canned food diets, so I know this is about dogs, but cats, but also dogs who are on can, looking for things like carrageenan, which is a known GI irritant. And over time, if your pet's having chronic diarrhea or vomiting issues, or they have inflammatory bowel disease, avoiding those ingredients can definitely help that gut lining heal. So I loved all those tips. I know those were fantastic. A lot of pet parents watching this can use those right away to assess their dog's quality of their pet food. So let's get into one of the most common conditions we see as veterinarians. And this is something that pretty much every dog at some point in its life is going to experience. And I know every single one of us here has dealt with this probably actually every single day. We have a patient that comes in that's experiencing this, and that's diarrhea. So I'd love to hear everyone's approach to how you'd help these dogs to clear up their diarrhea with some really neat tips that they can use for food as medicine, and also maybe some of your top supplements that you would use to help calm down inflammation, get things right again, to hopefully help pet parents avoid having to go to the ER and have an emergency visit. So Dr. Susan, I'll start with you.
Well, good. Because I was just thinking, the one thing that I hear, not all the time, but common enough to where I'm always like, no, is dog has diarrhea, so I stop feeding them for like a day. You know what I mean? And especially when we have these very senior dogs, if the dog starts to have diarrhea, sometimes people will think that if I feed them more, the diarrhea will, there'll be more diarrhea. You know, and I'm always like, no, I don't want this dog to now be hungry and start having a problem vomiting just because that we need to fix the diarrhea and address that, but still try to feed the dog. And so usually the recommendation of chicken and rice, which you'll get from a lot of, Western veterinary hospitals will just say, feed them chicken and rice for a couple of days. And I would do that. You know, I think that's a great idea. In Chinese medicine, we have kind of a comment on that, and that chicken and rice are both very gentle on the GI. They're both qi tonics. They're both very easy. So I always say, yes, chicken and rice is a great one. A little more, be careful, make sure it's a lot of chicken, because a lot of times those end up to be just a lot of rice. So, and then the other thing I would add on is scrambled egg can be very gentle. It's low fat naturally. It's very gentle on the stomach. Almost everyone's got egg in their fridge. I'm always kind of, you know, throwing that in there, but oftentimes, I mean, of course, as we know from veterinarians, we usually go, well, is it chronic or is it acute? You know, there's lots of different ways diarrhea can present. So the underlying cause is, of course, what we want to get to, both from a Western and an Eastern medicine standpoint. But in general, I would say can still feed them. And then we'll try to address the diarrhea. Usually I do change the diet. You know, initially, if we're somehow suspect of the diet, if we think it's something other than just, you know, they got into something they shouldn't have. But usually I try to think of what's not working. So if the dog is eating kibble, going outside, digging in the trash can, you know what I mean, getting a whole bunch of stuff and then having diarrhea, the problem is really that we got to get some better quality food in the bowl, try to get this dog's, you know, sort of nutrients up and sort of what we're feeding them to better quality. So they're not out there looking for, you know, everything under the sun that they could possibly eat other than that kibble that they're leaving there for all day long because they just don't want it. So I always tell them to go ahead and feed something different. If the dog feels better, right? They feel better. I fed them chicken and rice for 5 days. Dog feels great. It doesn't mean I put them back on the kibble, right? Because sometimes we kind of think, great, we're good. Back on the kibble. You know, that might be an opportunity to go, how else can I feed my dog to try to keep, especially if you're finding cycle of diarrhea keeps coming back and keeps coming back. We keep giving, you know, antibiotics to resolve and it keeps recurring. We got to start looking at something we're going to change fundamentally.
Great. Thanks, Susan. Nick, you're next.
Okay. So I tend to deal with chronic diarrhea because I'm not in first opinion practice anymore. So can I talk about chronic diarrhea cases?
Of course. Yeah, okay. Definitely. Thank you.
Okay. So just so that everybody can differentiate, if your dog is absolutely healthy and then gets really loose stool out of nowhere, that's called an acute diarrhea. Okay. Acute just refers to it's just suddenly appeared. If your dog is permanently producing sloppy poos, that's called a chronic diarrhea. And one of the little tips that I do with my clients is that I teach them very quickly. It takes 2 minutes. I'll teach you now. I've called it the Thompson stool score. So I may be famous one day for labeling poos. How about that? Okay, I call it the Thompson stool score because I've got to call it something and it makes it kind of funny. A 10 is a perfect torpedo. Okay, a 10 stool is a stool that you can pick up between two fingers. Yeah, really easy to put in a bag and put in the bin. And that's a 10 out of 10. A 0 is soup. Yeah, if you think of oxtail soup, that is your 0. There is 0 form to it. And a 5 out of 10 is kind of chocolate blancmange. Yeah. Do you guys have chocolate blancmange over
maybe
there?
Maybe like cow patty?
It's kind of cow patty. I always use, but it'd be slightly more formed perhaps than a cow. But cow pats are very, very variable feasts as well, actually, aren't they? You know? So I always use food. A pen isn't food, but you know what I mean. Food makes it stick in your head, yeah, because you can go, oh, that's kind of like blancmange. Oh, yeah, it must be a 5 out of 10. And it means that when I have a conversation with the client, I say, okay, how's Tilly doing? When we last spoke, she was producing fives. Every day she was producing fives. And they'll go, oh, it's great. She's now, 2 weeks later, we did X, Y, and Z, and she's now producing sevens. And so we can very accurately say, aha, we've had about, because it's, you know, depends on how you look at these things, but we've had about a 20% improvement in her case. And it means that they then can teach this to their vets and can have the same conversation, because one person's diarrhea is another person's absolutely perfect. My dog is, that's always, they're always like, I always have to scrape the stool off the sidewalk. Yeah. It's like, I'm sorry, that may be normal for your dog, but that's not right. Yeah. If you're producing sevens, you're 30% off the money. So I would suggest that that's the first thing to do is if your dog has got long-term loose stool, get used to scoring it, because then you can make changes and then you look in your diary from the week before to see how it compares this week to last week. Because if you've been doing these for a few weeks, then you might get a little confused. And the changes that I would suggest you do when you've got a dog who's really bright in themselves, but the poos are not great, I would suggest we do food trials. Doesn't matter whether you do fresh, cooked, or raw, or if you have to, kibble. But what you do is you just find single protein meals and you try those for a week or two each. And it's really important that you just stick to one protein for that week or 2 weeks, and then you see where that five goes. Does it go to a 10? Does it go to a 2? And in that way, you can actually assess which proteins really work for the dog and which proteins don't work so well for your dog. And after 12 weeks, you'll have 6 proteins in the bag, and maybe 2 of those proteins you absolutely know are not great with your dog, and the 4 proteins that you know are fantastic. And for the first time in 7 years of life, the dog is producing firm stool because there isn't low grade irritation to the gut. And it's the seat, as this summit will show. Good gut is the only way to get good health. And so that would be my thought. The only other thought would be, if you've got a dog with diarrhea, whether it's got chronic diarrhea or whether it's got acute diarrhea, if they are sick and ill and that's a completely different matter to if you've got a bright and chirpy dog. If you've got a bright and chirpy dog, go ahead, try things to help. If you've got a dull and sick dog, then you really need to get to the vet and just get those guys checked, because there may be other things going on. They may be very dehydrated. They may need a drip just to give them a boost. There you go. I'll shut up now.
No, that's great. Nick, I do have some follow-up questions actually, because I have a feeling that pet parents are going to have these questions.
Okay.
When you're doing that single protein diet change for a week at a time, are you only using like a meat source? Or are you adding in any fiber? Or are you adjusting that? Because I know with some of my patients, the fiber contents, they respond to that fiber content, and some also respond better to like a low residue diet. So how do you handle that with the pet parents?
Okay, I would go through this with the client, and I would usually go, in my practice, I would say we would go to an 80-10-10 meat, bone, viscera, and add some greens and just keep it really, really simple. So for example, in the UK where it's chilly, we'd go perhaps venison to start with for 2 weeks, 80-10-10 meat, bone, organ, and then we'd go rabbit, and then we'd go duck perhaps, and then we'd maybe go pork, or then we'd go goat, something like that. Those would be the kind of things. Fiber, you will get fiber from bone content, and you will get it from the vegetable, green vegetable content, I would suggest is a great idea. You and I use vegetable material for fiber, keep us regular. Dogs can use that, but they also use, when they're on a raw food diet, they will also use bony material, which is a really wonderful way to keep the gut. It's like sandpaper, really gentle sandpaper on the inside of the gut, keeps it really fresh, and it helps to bulk the stool. So that's the kind of thing that we would do. It's a good question though, Katie. Thank you.
Yeah. And actually, I do have a follow-up because I find a lot of my clients, if they add in, and it may be the difference geographically too, with the types of foods that are out there. And I have a feeling that's part of this, is that I find my clients, and I'm sure Susan and Katie experience this too, is that when we add organs in, and especially with like an upset GI tract, I find that sometimes them being very rich can actually make the diarrhea worse. So, and that might be because our dogs and the foods and maybe the quality of our food over here in the US may be playing a part to that. But what would be your thoughts on that for people?
Yeah. If you have, I don't usually find it a problem, which is why I go straight bowling straight in, 80, 10, 10, off you go. Because these, the dogs that I'm seeing, they've been squitting for 2 years, 3 years. So, and the owner has tried absolutely everything. And I find that the gut is so relieved to see real food that the impact of just 10% organ is not really too rich. If in doubt, though, I would remove viscera and I would just go with a mince, a meat mince, meat and bone mince, and really keep it simple there. It's a question of having that conversation. If they're unsure, then I don't think you can go, you can't start simple enough with these kind of diets. Keep it, you know, soups, even just go mince for a few days without bone, then maybe get some bone, some mince that's got a bone in it. I think that's keep it simple though. Really, really keep it simple.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that. And I think a lot of people get scared that if they're not feeding a balanced diet for a day, that it's going to harm their pets. Yeah. And we all laugh because it's one of those things that, do we eat a balanced diet every day? Of course not, right? And we haven't dropped down dead yet, which, knock on wood. But the biggest thing is that you can feed that really limited diet over a longer period of time to allow that your dog's gut to rest. So I love those tips, Nick. All right, Katie, you're up.
Yes. That's a perfect segue, because I also, and I'm sure Susan and, you know, with Chinese medicine training, we always call it balanced over time, you know, balanced over time. So I am also keep it simple when there's diarrhea. And I'm like Nick, I see a lot of chronic diarrhea because I'm a holistic, you know, specialist. So a lot of my patients coming to me have chronic diseases, and gut disease is one of the biggest things, of course, that we deal with. But regardless if it's acute or chronic, if it's acute, by the way, I'll just add in a quick tidbit. I like to do fecal tests too. We do see a lot of Giardia in my region. So it is wise, if it's acute or even if it's chronic, you know, getting a fecal test done with your veterinarian is a very wise thing to do. But regardless if it's acute or chronic, keeping it simple and sticking with one protein, I think, which, you know, all the docs are in agreement, is very sensible. And, you know, fiber generally, especially if it's a colitis, if it's a, you know, mucousy, liquidy, even bloody, oftentimes the colon will respond very well to some added fiber. A lot of pet parents get good success with adding canned pumpkin. I know pumpkin is a nice qi tonic. It's used a lot in Chinese medicine, food therapy. It's an easy one for people to get a hold of. Most dogs really like it. So, you know, chicken or turkey. I like to use turkey, you know, nice clean turkey source, ground turkey, and it's cooling. And so that tends to be, even for IBD or chronic GI diseases, turkey and pumpkin, I'm with Susan, more of the meat than the carbohydrate. Okay. So in the ratio of things, but keeping it simple, limited ingredient for a while until things are back on track. And then what I always tell people is our goal is never to stay limited ingredient. It might take a while. It might take several months. It depends on each patient and how we're going to progress. But our goal is always to expand variety in the diet and not to stay with limited ingredient. There are excellent tools, though, to use besides just dietary. And some of my favorite tools, even whether it's acute or chronic, some of my favorite tools to use for diarrhea, because symptoms are not fun. So, you know, if your dog's having blowout, liquidy, stage zero, you know, poop around your house, that we want to take care of symptoms as fast as we can while we're working on true gut healing and true, you know, response to a good diet and that sort of thing. So one of the things I love to use is a clay product. And some people may have heard of bentonite clay or montmorillonite clay. These clays are now made in products for dogs, you know, or you can use a similar human product. They can come in powders, the powders you would just mix into the food. These types of clays are very natural. They're from clay layers of the earth. They are known to be not only natural stool solidifiers, they're going to help to naturally bind up that stool, but they're also bowel detoxifiers. So if your pet gets into something bad, or say you got, you know, food poisoning, one of the reasons that your gut is reacting to something bad that you ate is the bacteria in that, you know, in that food are releasing toxins, enterotoxins, and these clays will bind up those toxins and bring them out of the body. And so it's much more proactive than using something like, you know, Imodium or some diarrhea stopper. It might stop the symptoms, but the whole reason the body has the symptoms in the first place is because we're trying to get stuff out. So with the clay, you are removing stuff, but also forming up the stool, which is such a beautiful thing. And there's no downside to clay. So I always tell people, if anybody in the house gets diarrhea, any dogs, just bust out the clay, get that started. If things aren't getting better, if they're not feeling good, we need to obviously, you know, go another step. But it's not going to bind any nutrients or food. It doesn't bind any supplements. So really, there's no contraindications ever to using clay. So I love that one. One of the other things that I love to use is slippery elm, or a formula with slippery elm in it. And there's a liquid formula that I use from a company called Animal Essentials, which has slippery elm, marshmallow root, licorice root, and plantain. Dr. Susan's, I'm sure, going to be a big fan of licorice root. It's used very commonly in Chinese herbal formulas. It's excellent for gut. Slippery elm, can't say enough good stuff about slippery elm. It is just a go-to for gut, but it helps with any mucosal surface. So it's also used in respiratory and chronic cough and things like that for mucosal calming, soothing, decreasing inflammation. It does that throughout the gut, upper gut. It's excellent for reflux too. It just soothes that esophageal and stomach, angry stomach type stuff. Also very soothing for the colon and the midgut as well, the small intestine and the large intestine. So I absolutely love slippery elm. It's much more proactive than, you know, a lot of the like sucralfate or carafate would be a prescription medication that would sort of soothe. But the great thing about slippery elm is that it soothes and calms inflammation, but it also supports tissue healing. And it's said to help the cells that line the gut actually get back to normal secretory function so that they're functioning better again. So it's soothing inflammation, healing the tissue, getting the gut functioning better again. So anything with slippery elm in it, or even slippery elm by itself, it can come in powders, liquids, adding that in, I feel is always an asset. So those are some of my top favorite things to do.
Those are great. And I was hoping someone would mention slippery elm. And going back to the testing, right? I live in Colorado, so Giardia is rampant here, making sure you don't have a secondary parasite. But also I find when there's diarrhea, you want it to stop and it's stressful and you don't want to clean up diarrhea all over your dog, all over your house. So what happens commonly is they get thrown on things like Flagyl or metronidazole, and it fixes the problem, but it can actually create more problems by affecting the microbiome. And so these are some great tips that you can use to help calm down that inflammation, and then figuring out, well, why did that happen? And that's the most important thing. Is there a food sensitivity? Are you feeding a species inappropriate diet and need to transition over? But I love having tools on hand. So getting that clay, having slippery elm, that Animal Essentials, I think you're referring to Colon Rescue. Is that? Yep. And so that's a great product. And also having RX Zymes is another one that has the slippery elm, marshmallow root, aloe to help soothe the digestive enzymes to help them digest their food a little bit better and take off some of that pressure off the pancreas too, to help them get back to normal. So those are some other tips that I find are really helpful for my patients. And using, I love like a mixture of like a canned pumpkin with like a ground turkey that's nice and cooling. That can be really helpful too, to transition over while they're having an upset tummy. So any other tips on diarrhea that anyone wants to chime in based on people's responses there?
Well, I want to add, go ahead.
Sorry, I was going to chime in. I was just going to mention that I'm very glad you brought up the metronidazole or Flagyl prescription that is commonly used and overused for every dog that has diarrhea. So many, you know, veterinarians will just go ahead and prescribe that. And so I'm glad you brought that up, Katie, because what I wanted to share with our audience is that I actually see clay and slippery elm and these kind of tools work better than metronidazole, and then you're not harming and affecting the microbiome and that. So thank you for bringing that up. I wanted people to get a perspective of it can work as good or better than traditional prescriptions that are given.
Yep. I see everyone shaking their heads too. So we've all helped patients through that numerous times without the use of metronidazole. So we're not just making that up.
Yes, it's true. I wanted to add one thing too about diarrhea and trying to do different foods, because I deal with a lot of clients who are trying to find the right diet for their dog. And I always say, do one protein as long as, and this is more upper GI and chronic diarrhea type of stuff, as long as the dog eats it, right? Like if the owner says, I did this, I'm going to do a 2-week trial of, you know, turkey, awesome. But if the dog says on day 5, I don't want to eat this anymore, you're changing. You have to, like, you can't, like, we're not playing, you know, sort of we're not going to sort of bully our dog into eating something they don't want to eat. I often say the dog gets the final say. So I'll say that I would like you on, you know, Katie, we always kind of joke that you can make the perfect Chinese medicine diet, just perfectly balanced. But if they don't eat it, then it's not going to help anybody. So usually I'll say if we're dealing with chronic diarrhea and we're thinking it's, you know, inflammatory bowel disease, I'll go, great, you know, I'll suggest our pork diet or our fire diet, which is our turkey diet. But I'll say, I'm going to send you both, because then I want you to have an A and I want you to have something in your back pocket, because sometimes, not always, but if the chronic diarrhea comes along with poor appetite, I put the poor appetite front and center. If you don't eat well today, you're not feeling good no matter what. So that's kind of the only thing I would add to the food diet trials is dog has to agree.
Yeah, I completely agree with that. I'm going to chime in, as everybody has, another thing. Probiotics can be very useful in this scenario. The one that we use, it's an American product. They don't pay me for this, unfortunately. It's called Phytosport. Is that coming out the right way around?
Yeah, with you?
Yep. Is that backwards?
Yeah. No, it's coming up right.
Okay, there you go. Phytosport, Microbiome Labs. Other products are available, but this one, I find it's really, really useful. I've even found prescribing it has had impact on behavioral cases, which is really, really interesting. Anxiety has come down, which is no surprise because the gut and the brain, there's a strong link there. But it's a really nice probiotics that we use with any upset to try and help to reestablish some order. It has been trialed with dogs, and so there is science behind it, and it's one of the few that's actually designed for dogs, as opposed to using a human probiotic or one with a very limited spectrum of bacteria in it. In this country, there's only one licensed bug that you can use in a probiotic, so they're not very good, whereas that is a great product from the States, Phytospore.
Yeah, I love that one. I use that quite a bit actually with my patients, and we actually have a talk on prebiotics and probiotics in the Gut Summit, so that'll be great for everyone to watch, because there's a lot of different probiotics out there, and it's important to know the difference between a prebiotic and a probiotic. So I love that you shared that also. Anything else that you feel like that people should know about diarrhea right now?
Oh, hey, one more thing. Since we're showing our favorite product, I have a new one that I like. This is also I'm also not paid for it, and that's also not by prescription. It's called Doggy Stat.
Yeah, I've seen that one.
Yeah. I've seen some really good results with this one. It's natural and it's done some a lot of studies originally with parvovirus, but it's also just a really great anti-diarrheal. So it's kind of nice to see something out there other than our standard, you know, metronidazole, which we're all familiar with, pros and cons.
And I'll make one more comment too, since Nick brought up the great probiotic discussion, is that I really like to encourage fermented foods in pet diets too. And so one of my concerns is, you know, I used to recommend actually consistent use of probiotics for all of my patients, just keep them on it, you know, find a good probiotic product. But now that we're learning so much more about the microbiome and how we really want to support the microbiome to be this diverse ecosystem that it should be. And so the concern is that, you know, if you stay on, especially like Nick said, something with a very limited population or variety of beneficial bacteria in it, you're sort of, you know, narrowing up the microbiome by constantly putting that in, and, you know, they're kind of taking over as the, you know, the small monoculture in the gut. And so I really like to food medicine also include fermented foods as part of the program in building up the, you know, microbiome and the gut health that way. And if you're using fermented veggies, you get some pre, you know, if it's cabbage, I mean, you get some prebiotic and probiotic in the same food, which is a win-win. So fermented foods are always on my list too.
Yeah, I love that. I love the food as medicine and your cabbages and using these other foods, you're getting other great antioxidants and other phytochemicals that are supporting the body, which is another reason why we add in some of these vegetables too, even though, you know, we don't necessarily need to, but we're learning that we do because of that microbiome and how much it truly helps feed them and gain that diversity for that gut microbiome. So I appreciate everyone's feedback and input. And I know pet parents gained so many tools with what everyone just said to help get their pets back through. And I know Nick is raising his hand again. Yes, Nick.
I wasn't sure whether you were going to end it because I was
not yet.
You know, okay, because I've got one trump card that I want to play before we finish. That's all.
Awesome. It's coming. So what we want to do is make sure, I would love to hear all the pet parents' feedback and how these presentations, how these interviews are helping to support your dog's gut health to help them achieve optimal health. So I'm going to be watching for that feedback throughout this entire gut summit. And so Nick and everyone, what final tip would you each like to leave with our pet parents today? I'll start with you, Nick, because I know you're jumping out of your seat.
I had this dreadful vision of me holding my trump card and you going, thanks, bye. I've got this thing that I want to share with everybody. It's bone broth, guys. It's just a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful thing. A bone broth, there are lots of different recipes. Dr. Karen Becker and Rodney Habib are bringing out their Forever Dog book soon, and there's a great recipe in there. But really, it's pretty simple stuff. You get bones. If your dog can tolerate chicken, you get loads of chicken bones and chicken wings and carcass and what have you. Put it in a bowl, put it in a big pan with a lid, because otherwise you'll lose it all. And you cook it for at least 8 hours. Okay, that's the simple, simple, simple version. That's as complicated as it needs to be. You can put herbs in right at the end, and they can mellow out into the bone broth as well. You then take out all the bones and you dispose of them. They are deadly for dogs because they can be very brittle. So those don't go anywhere near the dog. And if the meat, you can give it to the dog, you can have it yourself because it's all perfectly cooked. And that's your bone broth. If you want a low fat bone broth, you skim off the fat from the top and you just use the juice. Okay. And it's very useful in a diarrhea case because it's very hydrating. It's and it contains glutamine. Dr. Susan was talking about maintaining food through the gut, because if the gut is empty, you will get a sloughing off of the very, very thin enterocyte layer, and bone broth keeps those enterocytes really, really happy. So it's nourishing, it's warming, not too warming, it's hydrating, and it will help to maintain electrolytes, sodium and chloride and potassium, which you will lose when you have either an acute or a chronic diarrhea. So there are a few conditions in veterinary medicine that won't benefit from a bone broth. Some dogs are very itchy and they can't cope with it. But apart from that, I think bone broth is one of the most wonderful things that you can do for the dog. And if your dog is healthy and happy, you can have it as a little treat. Or in the summer, you can put it into little ice cubes and they can have a little crunchy treat as well. So it's good. So bone broth is my top tip to everybody. And it's fun to make. So it's good. Great.
Love it. That's great. I'm glad you brought that up. All right, Katie, I'll have you go next.
Awesome. I was going to say thank you for bringing that up too, because one of my favorite foods to recommend to everybody is indeed bone broth, and perfect in this topic because it is very gut healing and it is one of the top foods on healing leaky gut list, as fermented foods and bone broth are right up there. I literally call bone broth a healing potion. I tell that to people all the time. And I provide a list of what I call medicinal foods or beneficial foods And I customize it for each patient depending on their weight size or once I learn a little bit more about their digestion and how sensitive it is and things like that. But I literally have a medicinal food list, and I tell everyone my prescription list for your pet is going to start with food. And bone broth indeed is like on the top of the list. And fermented foods, and I have things like eggs. I love how Susan brought up, you know, that a lightly cooked egg or raw egg is excellent. I have sardines on the list, a very low or uncontaminated, you know, source of omega-3s, unlike salmon and tuna, which tend to be a lot more contaminated. So I have this medicinal food list, and that's something I really like to support my, you know, patients or my clients to have. I tell them, you know, our goal is to get to fresh food diet. But if you are still feeding kibble or even something dehydrated, adding these foods in, enhancing their diet to be, you know, more fresh and nutrient dense is going to profoundly impact their health no matter what the mainstay of the diet is. And then we can work on that too. But yeah, medicinal foods, gut healing foods, and bone broth is phenomenal. And, you know, lots of good things that people can add in. So.
Great. I love that, Katie. Thanks for sharing. And Susan.
Yeah, I would suggest, I always tell clients, you know, if you're busy, we're all busy and you've got lots of stuff going on and you just want to add something to your dog's bowl. First thing I say is, if you can do nothing else, crack an egg, put it on their bowl. And if they say, well, should I cook it or should I have it raw? And I go, well, if they have a healthy gut, raw is great because then they can just, it's like they got in the chicken coop. You know, if they are more sensitive, so you have a very senior dog, especially very senior, GI sensitive, youngster, maybe cook it. But really I try to get clients to think about putting more color in the bowl, putting some real food. So for that, when I have, you know, really big dogs, I've got two Rottweilers in the house, then we're going to say, okay, we'll do some, maybe you're going to do some fresh food diet, and then you're going to use some home cooking. And that home cooking, once if they have a nice healthy gut, can be my leftover breakfast and my leftover lunch, because we should all be eating real food. That's a good way to get some natural rotation in there. So I like to try to have clients do, so they're like, when they have like our Chi Dog diets, they'll say, well, what should I cook? And I'll say, well, you know, we're sending you a diet that's ground beef, you know, and kale and little carrots. So cook that. You know what I mean? Like, it's literally just food. So it's just kind of, we really want to try to get people the idea of our dogs can eat food just like us. It really is better for them. And what a wonderful way to care for them. I mean, it's really, you know, it's kind of makes you feel good when you get to cook them something and then they get to eat it. It's nice.
That's great. Thank you for sharing. And I think the biggest thing that I want to, the takeaway, all of these tips and tools are great, and they're not necessarily meant to be implemented all at once. And if that feels super overwhelming to you, start small. And I feel like, you know, whether it's starting bone broth or whether it's adding that egg to the diet or whether it's just adding a little bit of leftover veggies from dinner, if that's all that you can manage right now, that will make a huge impact to your dog's gut health and their overall health. So just start small and work your way up to it. And there's plenty of amazing veterinarians across the world, as you can see, just from a few here that are willing to help and guide if you need additional support. So thanks again, everyone, for being here. And we really look forward to hearing from all the incredible pet parents here and your thoughts throughout the next few days of the Dog Gut Health Summit. Once again, I'm Dr. Katie Woodley, your host and your guide through the next 4 days. So take care, and we'll see you all tomorrow.